love of Christ proclaim, till all the world adore his sacred name. Led on their way by this triumphant sign, the host of God in conquering ranks combine. Lift high the cross, the love of Christ proclaim, till all the world adore his sacred name. Each newborn servant of the crucified bears on the brow the seal of him who died. Lift high the cross, the love of Christ proclaim, till all the his sacred name.
I am the salvation of the people, says the Lord. Should they cry to me in any distress, I will hear them, and I will be their Lord forever.
I will hear them, and I will be their Lord forever.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Well, good morning again, everyone, and welcome on this beautiful and glorious day that the Lord has made. We gather here each week in this sacred space to encounter the real presence of Jesus. We meet him as he prepares us in the word, in the scriptures that are proclaimed, which leads us then to his table of sacrifice, the altar, where he gives us his very self, his body and his blood. We also encounter him in one another. He's present where two or three are gathered in his name. And so let's take a moment now and greet one another and welcome the Christ in our midst. Brothers and sisters, Jesus teaches us, and he teaches the disciples in today's gospel about who they ought to be, servants of all. As we call to mind our sins, let us ask for God's mercy for those times that we have put ourselves before others. Lord Jesus, you teach us that the last shall be first. Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Christ Jesus, you conquered death by being raised to new life. Christe eleison.
Christe eleison.
Lord Jesus, you came among us as the suffering servant. Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you,
give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God Almighty Father, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world. Receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in the glory of God the Father. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who founded all the commands of your sacred law upon love of you and of our neighbor, grant that by keeping your precepts, we may merit to attain eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. The wicked say, "Let us beset the just one, because he is obnoxious to us. He sets himself against our doings, reproaches us for transgressions of the law, and charges us with violations of our training. Let us see whether his words be true. Let us find out what will happen to him. For if the just one be the Son of God, God will defend him and deliver him from the hands of his foes. With revilement and torture, let us put the just one to the test, that we may have proof of his gentleness and try his patience. Let us condemn him to a shameful death, for according to his own words, God will take care of him."
The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Lord upholds my life. The Lord upholds my life. O God, by your name save me, and by your might defend my cause. O God, hear my prayer, hearken to the words of my mouth. The Lord upholds my life. For the haughty men have risen up against me. The ruthless seek my life. They set not God before their eyes. The Lord upholds my life. Behold, God is my helper. The Lord sustains my life. Freely will I offer you sacrifice. I will praise your name, O Lord, for its goodness. The Lord upholds my life.
A reading from the letter to St. James. Beloved, where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there is disorder in every foul practice. But the wisdom from above is first of all pure, then peaceable, gentle, compliant, full of mercy and good fruits, without inconstancy or insincerity. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace, for those who cultivate peace. Where do the wars and where do the conflicts among you come from? Is it not from your passions that make war within your members? You covet, but do not possess. You kill and envy, but you cannot obtain. You fight and wage war. You do not possess because you do not ask. You ask, but do not receive, because you ask wrongly, to spend it on your passions.
The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. God has called us through the gospel to possess the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus and his disciples left from there and began a journey through Galilee, but he did not wish anyone to know about it. He was teaching his disciples and telling them, "The Son of Man is to be handed over to men, and they will kill him, and 3 days after his death, the Son of Man will rise." But they did not understand the saying, and they were afraid to question him. They came to Capernaum, and once inside the house, he began to ask them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they remained silent. They had been discussing among themselves on the way who was the greatest. Then he sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "If anyone wishes to be first, he shall be the last of all and the servant of all." Taking a child, he placed it in their midst, and putting his arms around it, he said to them, "Whoever receives one child such as this in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but the one who sent me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
One of the many surprising things we find in the New Testament is its blatant honesty. We see that in today's gospel. The 12 apostles, Jesus' hand-chosen and closest companions. But in our gospel today, they make a very poor showing. Now, they've been traveling along with the Lord on those dusty roads of Galilee. And as they've been traveling, he's been explaining to them about what the Messiah really is all about, and that soon he must go to Jerusalem, where he'll be arrested, unjustly condemned, mocked, and then crucified in a most horrible way. But the apostles, like many of the Jews of Jesus' day, had a preconception, a political idea of what the Messiah was to be, and it didn't fit their scheme. So as they're walking along, and after Jesus explains this to them, they're discussing among themselves about his kingdom, but not as the kingdom as he's proclaiming it, but as they see it. And it's not a kingdom that's spiritual, but rather they really believe that Jesus is going to lead some sort of successful political rebellion against the occupying Romans. And then as they're discussing this political kingdom of Jesus, they're arguing now about positions in this so-called kingdom. Who will be prime minister? Who will be secretary of the treasury or defense minister? It's amazing how what Jesus has told them, that should have shocked them, but it just sort of went right over their heads, and they're blind. As Jesus says, they have eyes, but they don't see. They have ears, but they don't hear. And so they're arguing about these positions, and this tells us very clearly that these apostles certainly do not understand the real nature of Jesus' kingdom, and they won't understand it until after his death and resurrection and the coming of the Holy Spirit. But the fact of the matter is this, is that Jesus' kingdom is not a political or military entity. When we pray, "Thy kingdom come," in the Lord's Prayer, we are not praying for a political kingdom to come. Jesus' kingdom is a spiritual reality, and the reign of God's will in the hearts of his followers. That's what the kingdom of God is. That is why Jesus' sacrifice on that cross is not a terrible failure. It looks like that on the outside from the external appearance, but it is an eternal triumph in the internal way. When we let God's will reign in our hearts, it will involve the cross.
as we heard last week's gospel. And that involves giving up of oneself, self-denial. It involves saying not just, "Thy kingdom come," but also what follows, "And thy will be done." Thy will be done. And that sets us up always for the clash. There's the clash or conflict between God's eternal wisdom, which is his will and the source of his will, and the selfish preferences and tendencies of our weak and fallen human nature. And that conflict, that confrontation, is really what's behind the whole cross. And everyone must endure that cross. And Jesus was the first to endure it in the fullest way possible. He endured the full pain of that clash without caving in. And because of that, he wins our redemption. Christ's kingdom then entails the interior victory of God's love over self-seeking love, not the exterior victory of military or political conquest. Let's look at this from another direction, this sense of the exterior and interior in the kingdom of God. In this sense, the life of every Christian, we are called to be like the Eucharist. The Eucharist, that little host that we receive in communion time. I have one right here. It's not consecrated, so don't worry. But just from the exterior, on the outside, it looks entirely worthless. It's probably worth, by earthly standards, a couple of pennies. It's flimsy, it's pale, and it's fragile. And yet, once it's on that altar there with the consecration, beneath those unimpressive appearances, God himself will dwell. Jesus Christ, fully in his flesh and blood. Jesus, who is the creator and redeemer of this world. Now, when God reigns in our hearts, we too may look by appearance plain, fragile, on the outside. But on the inside, we are filled with God's everlasting treasures. And just as through the centuries, the Eucharist, whose appearance is so humble, it has inspired some of the most magnificent achievements of humanity. Think of those towering cathedrals in Europe built by those people in the Middle Ages, or the breathtaking works of art through the centuries inspired by people of faith, as well as the exquisite music and literature. And one can never overlook the heroic self-sacrifice of so many holy men and women, the saints. In a similar way, when we allow God to rule our hearts from within, we also become powerful forces of inspiration in this world. It's not because we're beautiful or eloquent or talented in some exterior way, but because we are vessels of God's grace within. We are filled with God's grace, and that grace is God's supernatural influence that works in so many hidden ways, sort of like the radio waves that are all around us. Think for a moment about Blessed Mother Teresa of Calcutta as an example here. She was only a tiny, frail, humble Albanian nun, and yet Christ reigned fully in her heart, and even long after her death, she continues to inspire this world. Or think of St. Teresa of Lisieux, the little flower. She was a young, middle-class French girl who entered the convent at the age of 15, and before she was 25, she was dead. And she lived during those years in that convent a very hidden life. No one noticed her. Even her own confrères in that convent really didn't notice her. And when she did die, her companions there at the convent didn't even know what to write in the convent diary. On the outside, she was a no one. And such an uneventful life from the outside. But gradually, after her death, the richness of her interior life, her interior experience of God, started to become known. And now, many years later, we have her autobiography, which has become one of the best-selling books at all times, written in dozens of languages. And she's even been named a doctor of the church. Jesus' kingdom is a spiritual reality. It is not political. However, that does not mean that Christ's followers have nothing to say about the political and politics. And this is a very common misunderstanding in our world today, particularly in this culture that we live. We hear a lot about separation of church and state and that church should know its boundaries. Well, that phrase can be interpreted in two different ways. One is right, the other is wrong. In the first place, it can mean that the government of a country doesn't try to run the church, and in turn, the church doesn't try to run the government. That's the right way to understand separation of church and state. But there's also a wrong way to understand it, a way that's becoming more and more the thinking of our leaders and our politicians and so many others. And the wrong viewpoint says this, that religion is really a private thing. It's like a private hobby, like butterfly collecting. And so it really has nothing to contribute to the public life of a community or a country. In other words, in the words of some of our political leaders, I won't mention names, but faith should only be within these four walls, and that's where you're supposed to keep it, and nowhere else. That's not what it's about. You see, there is one area in life where politics and faith do overlap, and that's morality. Governments, in order to do their job well and to make just laws, have to respect natural moral law, like the Ten Commandments. This natural law, which is being neglected completely by Western civilization, is really written into our human nature. It's sort of like our spiritual DNA. And it exists prior to politics, and it provides healthy parameters for political activity. In the same way that the laws of physics existed prior to the invention of rockets, and it provides the parameters for space travel. Governments need clear knowledge of the natural moral law to do their job, just as much as engineers need clear knowledge of the natural physical laws to do theirs. And God has made the church that Jesus founded intentionally as the sure teacher and guide on questions of natural moral law. And so, getting back to ourselves, we Catholics do have a lot to contribute beyond these four walls. in the discussion of public affairs. It is up to us to be the conscience of our country. And so, my friends, as we continue this liturgy today, we should ask God to grant us the grace not only to allow his spiritual kingdom to spread in our own hearts, but also to give us that boldness, that wisdom, that courage to be his messengers in this world around us, which is in such dire need of moral guidance. God bless you.
We now stand and profess our faith together as we say, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Jesus instructs us to become servants of all. Let us pray to God for the strength to die to ourselves and to bring life to others. Our response is, Lord, give us strength. Lord, give us strength.
For Pope Francis and all the faithful who will travel to meet and worship with the Holy Father this week, may the Holy Spirit guide and protect them. We pray.
Lord, give us strength.
For all churches, agencies, employers, and healthcare providers, may they be free from government mandates that would compel them to compromise their beliefs. We pray.
Lord, give us strength.
For victims of violence and natural disasters, and for all those who suffer from poverty and illness, we pray.
Lord, give us strength.
For those gathering with Pope Francis for the World Meeting of Families, may all families be sanctuaries of truth, guided by the love of Christ. We pray.
Lord, give us strength.
For Daniel Waresky and Kristen Retzloff, who were united in the sacrament of marriage, may their love be a beacon of light to the world. We pray.
Lord, give us strength.
For all the living and deceased members of Most Blessed Sacrament Parish, for intentions in our prayer books and on our prayer line, and for the intentions we hold in our hearts. We pray,
Lord, give us strength.
For Mary Hughes and Eleanor Urban, who have gone before us marked with the sign of faith, and for all those who have died, in particular we pray for Thomas Zellner, Eleanor Ryan, and Clayton Hayes, May they rejoice in the kingdom of heaven. We pray.
Lord, give us strength.
O God, you sent your Son to teach us how to be servants of all. Hear these our prayers, that we might one day take our place with you in the fullness of life. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Though I walk amid distress, you preserve me. Against the anger of my enemies, you raise your hand. Your right hand saves me. Your right hand saves me. Brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Receive with favor, O Lord, we pray, the offerings of your people, that what they profess with devotion and faith may be theirs through these heavenly mysteries, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For through his paschal mystery, he accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of being now called a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for your own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works, for you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest, in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
And therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and David, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. And there we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Savior's command and form of divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. You have laid down your precepts to be carefully kept. May my ways be firm in keeping your statutes. May my ways be firm in keeping your statutes.
We remember how you loved us.
and we believe that we will see you when you come in your glory, Lord. Remember, we celebrate, we
please be seated. Prayer to St. Michael. St. Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our defense against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Let us pray. Graciously raise up, O Lord, those you renew with this sacrament, that we may come to possess your redemption both in mystery and in the manner of our life, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The confirmation meeting, I believe, is downstairs right after our Mass. Kathy's shaking her head, yes, so I'm right. And the Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Go forth. The Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
We are companions on the journey, breaking bread and sharing life. And in the love we bear is the hope we share. For we believe in the love of our God. We believe in the love of our God. No longer strangers to each other, no longer strangers in God's house. We are fed and we are nourished by the strength of those who care, by the strength of those who care. We are companions on the journey, breaking bread and sharing life. And in the love we bear is the hope we share. For we believe in the love of our God. We believe in the love of our God.